Well, as you can see, Tim is not here this week, so you've got me.
Amen.
Thank you. Tim's over in Tennessee visiting with Bo. There's four generations of Rolands all together. Did anyone see the picture of Pops with Bo on Facebook? Wasn't that great? Very, very good. So they're having a great time over there. All six of them, I think, went over. Okay, some announcements today. Baptism. If you're interested in baptism, just put it on a card, put it in the offering. We haven't yet picked a date, but we're working on that. So if you're interested in getting baptized, or if your kids are interested in getting baptized, put it on the card, and then we'll contact you about a date as soon as we have one. Before I forget, because I've forgotten the last one, the Easter services, 8 o'clock, 9:30, and 11 o'clock. All three of them are here in the sanctuary. So there's nothing over in the bridge for Easter. So those are the Easter service times. The R3 Men's Conference. So I think five of us went to the men's conference yesterday from here, which was great. It was a good conference. I had to duck out a little early, but from what I saw of it, very, very good content. It's great to see so many men from Fresno and this general area in one place worshiping and listening to some great sermons, some great breakout sessions on a lot of different things about how to lead families and celebrate recovery. Had one session and money and things like that. So that was a really, really good conference yesterday at New Covenant. The Widow Lunch Bunch, that is meeting today at Andy Armour's restaurant over in Clovis by Sierra Vista Mall. That's at 12:30 today. The pie auction. We cannot not mention the pie auction. What a great night. $21,000. I mean, not just, you know, record turnout, record amount of things to auction, and a record amount of money. That's awesome. Thank you very much to everybody that bid on stuff, that brought stuff, that just helped support in any way. That was a great night, and we'll go a really long way towards the Mexico mission. And, you know, I know the youth department is just beside themselves. Chris is convinced, and he can really now see the value in the pie auction. I think you just blew him away with it, frankly. So thank you very much for all of that, all of your support on that. Membership, if you are thinking about becoming a member or you just want to know more about membership, please fill out a card, put it in the offering, and I will contact you in the near future. I have a couple on my desk I need to take care of, so if you're saying, well, yeah, I filled it out and I didn't get it yet, I will take care of that next week. So I'll send you a form and some information about a statement of faith, and then we'll have a meeting. And that's kind of how the membership process goes. So if you're interested in membership, fill out a card, put it in the offering. The Women's Retreat, Calvin Crest Retreat. That's on April 15th through 17th. Registration for that is in the pavilion. So you can sign up there, or you can go online to calvincrest.com and sign up online if you don't want to do that out there or you forget to do it on the way out. Also, for the women that signed up the Mexico Mission goodie bags, those are due on March 18th. So if you're committed to that or you would like to do that, that's when they're due in the office this coming Friday. Also for a calendar item, June 6th, for those of you with elementary school kids, there's a jam session starting again June 6th. I think it's 9 or 10 weeks. It's on the parables. There'll also be a adjoining adult study in the office. We haven't quite got the subject matter for that yet, but it'll be starting at the same time, April 6th. The Road to Resurrection. So what in the past, what we've done at Easter time for the kids is Jennifer and I have put together a sort of station-type activity where it's the last week of Jesus' life, and the kids go from one station to the next, and they experience different things, have story time, and that kind of stuff. What we decided to do this year is to do it on a Wednesday night, because we've been doing jam sessions on a Wednesday night, so we just thought we'd do it Wednesday night. And it's kind of open house style, so it'll be 5 o'clock through 7:30 will be the starting of each of the walkthroughs. So we're going to convert the Jam Center into different areas that relate to the last week of Jesus' life, starting with the Last Supper, and then there's the prison, Barabbas' prison, then there's foot of the cross, and then there's the resurrection, and that'll all be the four stations ending up in the bridge with fellowship and snacks in there. So it starts at 5 o'clock. You don't have to be here at 5 o'clock. So those with families that want to walk through it, or anyone that wants to walk through it, it'll be probably about every 15 minutes we'll be starting a new walkthrough. And it takes about an hour. And there'll be people acting out things in costume, and the Jam Center will be decorated. It'll be an awesome event. We're very excited about it, and we hope a lot of families and kids come through that, or even people just interested come take a look. But thank you very much for everyone that signed up for all the supplies that we needed for that. We got everything covered last week. We're just still looking for a few volunteers here and there. That's people to either lead the groups through, or to, if you want to act something out, then if you want to try a bit of acting, there's a good place to try it. Kids are not that judgmental. So, anyway, so thank you for people that gave all of the supplies for that. That was exceptionally great that we got it covered in a single week. A couple of prayer requests. Laura Lee Brown, Steve Brown's wife, lost her mother. She passed away, and they are in Indiana. The service for that was yesterday, so please keep them in your prayers as they get over that and look for comfort there. Larry Markland. Larry Markland's been coming for this church for over 12 years, and unfortunately, he had a heart attack Tuesday, and he passed away in the hospital. Services for him will be this coming Friday, the 18th, here at New Hope. But please keep that family in your prayers, and Sharon, very much needed prayers on that. So that is all of the announcements I have right now. There is some paper that we're going to, this will all become clear later. So we're just going to pass this around kind of like a clipboard, but it's not. So if you just take a piece of paper and, obviously it's not, but take a piece of paper, pass it on, and then I'll explain what we're going to do with it later. But anyway, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just give all glory and thanks to you. Your kingdom is exceptional, and we're a part of it, and we're just grateful to be servants in your kingdom and doing your kingdom's work. We just pray today for the families that we mentioned, and for those that haven't been mentioned but on the hearts of everyone here. So we just pray for them, that they find comfort through you. And Lord, we just pray that the message today will speak to people, and that we can really look to you to confess and find redemption through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we give thanks for the ministries that are so busy in this church. We give thanks for all the support that we get for each of these ministries. And we just pray this in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Today we're going to be continuing our journey through Psalms. And we're going to rest on Psalm 32 today. Psalm 32. It's not a very long chapter, but it's pretty power-packed, so this one's really worth doing and listening to, because, you know, if you've been around Long Hope, New Hope a little bit this year, then you'll realize that we've been doing the little or less and more lifestyle, the less TV, more Bible study, less distractions, more prayer time. Less TV, did that one, less self, TV is really on my mind, less self and more God, whatever less, more lifestyle or version of it that you're living this year or trying to live this year. Today we're going to look at how David dealt with some of his problems through Psalm 32. But I want you first to imagine that you've been out shopping at a restaurant or even here at church. And you finish what you're doing, you go back to the parking lot where your car is. You approach your car, and under the windshield wiper, you see a small note. So you pull it out, and it's a handwritten note that just says, "I know what you did." Don't worry, you're not going to have notes out in your car. Well, that would have been good. I didn't think about that until then. So what comes to mind? What's the first thing that comes to your mind when you pick up that note and read that? Your reaction is probably going to be based around the thing that you feel the most guilty about. The thing that's been weighing heaviest on your mind will come to the surface pretty quickly. And you get that feeling in your stomach, that unsettling feeling that something that you've been trying to keep deep down and hidden has come to light. Somebody knows about it, and it's come to light, and it's not a very good feeling. It sounds like the start of a movie, but the reality is that we've all had things that we've done that we feel guilty about. After all, we're humans. One of Edgar Allan Poe's most famous short stories was The Telltale Heart. And this goes that the main character has committed murder. And he buries the victim's body under the floorboards in the very room where he committed the murder. Well, there's a knock at the door, and the police are there. The police have been called because they heard someone cry out. So someone called them, and the police came. And he was happy to show them around the house. He was feeling pretty confident. In fact, to the point where he brought chairs from the rest of the house into the room where he committed the murder and buried the body. And the police and he sat around just chatting for a while. But soon he starts to hear a relentless sound that starts to drive him crazy. Well, the police are sitting there in the room, but they don't seem to be reacting to it at all. They're just carrying on with their conversation. But the distraction becomes so strong that soon it causes him to break down and tear up the floorboards, revealing the body and trying to silence the sound of the dead man's heart that has been thumping in his brain. It's not a sound that was audible to anyone else in the room, only to him. But the guilt of his deed quickly overshadowed his confidence about how good a job he'd done in hiding the body. So he was driven to reveal himself as a murderer through a sound that only he could hear. And that's the thing about guilt. It's not visible to those around you, yet it's a powerful emotion that at times makes you feel like the weight of the world is on your shoulders. And today's Psalm 32 is written by David, and it closely links to one of the other Psalms, 51. Because they're both written after the adulterous affair that David had with Bathsheba and the further act of trying to cover it up by having her husband killed on the battlefield. These are not light things that he did. And this kind of thing would weigh heavy on even the most hardened heart. But we're talking about David. He was the chosen one of God to lead the king, to be the king of God's people. And David had been ruling for quite some time before this happened. So he was ill prepared for such an aftermath of this sin. So Psalm 32 starts with the heading, Maskil. It says of David, a Maskil. This is a word that's thought to mean that the psalm was there to teach us. Teach us something that David had learned for himself and was passing along in the form of a song. The longer translation of this word would be the power to see into a situation. These are life instructions from David. And they learn from his own experience, but they're not the only one that's labeled like that. There's 12 other psalms in the book that is labeled a maskil. So yes, Psalms is a book of songs, but it's also a book of instruction. So we read the first two verses of Psalm 32. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. We can see that David's opening up this by rejoicing. He's rejoicing the forgiveness of God. That's an upbeat start, not the sort of thing you'd expect to see when he's coming off such a scandalous circumstances. But you have to remember that he wrote this after the fact. He was writing about his whole experience and his anguish and guilt, and it's in the past. He has obvious joy at this point. These two verses do have a familiar ring, though. Blessed is. It's the Beatitude format. If you think of Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5, the start of that is, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And then there's a whole list of blessed are. But here in verse 3, David had, blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sin is covered. So he's starting with the good news. He is blessed. He's using his experience to make this statement. You can sense the relief now because in the next two verses, David looks back at how he felt when he was in his guilt. So when I kept silent, verse 3, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Bones are the structures of our body, the strong frame that holds everything else upright. And David is saying here that, well, he kept silent. That is, well, he didn't confess and acknowledge what he had done. And while he kept his sin to himself, it was inside of him and he was eating away at his bones, decaying the structure of his body through the decay of his soul. This internal anguish was causing him to moan, or at least sigh heavily. You ever been in a situation where you just want to sigh? Feels good. Makes you feel better. It's like torment leaving your body. So anxiety brings out sighing in an effort to, your body's effort to reoxygenate itself after shallow breathing. Like we're very anxious, we constantly breathe shallow. But it could also have been moaning out loud, woe is me. But back to the text, it says, for day and night your hand was heavy on me, my strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Well, David felt the weight of God on him, not literally pushing him into the ground, but pushing on his heart. His conscience was saturated with guilt, and he felt like a huge weight on him. Those who have had problems with this type of weight of anxiety and depression, they feel sapped of energy, seemingly unable to move. Physical symptoms from psychological problems, but every bit as real as a person with a physical injury. David was unable to motivate himself. He was physically challenged as if the heat had dried him up like a plant left out in the scorching sun, shriveling up. He was a spiritual drought and distant from God. He paints a powerful picture of how this was really affecting him. In this case, guilt had caused David to really slip into a depression, a state complete crippling anxiety. But guilt can manifest itself in a lot of different ways. A lot of people have problems moving on in life, finding the next thing to do, unable to find direction. The guilt becomes what feels like an anchor chained around the neck and is stuck in the past, thinking constantly about what happened and not being able to find joy in anything or doing anything to move their lives along. Living in the past will always leave holes in the present and in the future, and it stops us from living our lives to its fullest potential. Some people deal with guilt by ignoring it. It's a decision to live life by a different moral code. After all, isn't guilt something created by experiences we have as children or as young people that help us to differentiate between right and wrong? Well, of course, how would we know something is wrong if we don't know what's right? So the process would go, I'm just going to change my thinking. And I'd go with a viewpoint that it's not wrong, so I won't feel guilty about that anymore. Then I got to work my way through all the things that are frowned upon by moral people and change my thinking so it's not wrong. I'm also going to hang out with others who feel the same way I do. It's not wrong if it feels good or it's not hurting anyone. But then where does that lead? We get so far from the road of acceptable that we find it hard to pull ourselves back and redirect ourselves. And everyone we know is doing the same thing, so it's hard to even recognize that we've drifted that far in the first place. We don't need approval anymore. We don't need approval from God. We do what we want to do. And if we do want approval, well, we're surrounded by people that will give us approval because they're doing the same thing that we're doing, even if it's wrong. There was a man in Texas who was charged with horse stealing, but he claimed to be innocent. He was asked if he preferred to be tried by a judge or a jury of his peers. He said, "What's peers?" So they explained to him they're people just like him. He said, "Oh, I'll take the judge. I don't want to be tried by a bunch of horse thieves." So we surround ourselves often with those who think just the way that we do. This helps to maintain an image of innocence or eliminate guilt about what we did wrong. Imagine the power of surrounding yourself with people who want to follow God's path. They want to learn about His word. And they want to introduce people to the joy of living in a relationship with Christ. We all want the sense of belonging, but it works both in the good and the bad. A more extreme version of guilt is illustrated in literature, in Macbeth, a play written by Shakespeare. If you're not familiar with the story, I'll give you the kind of short version of it, the Cliff's Notes, or whatever people use now. If nothing else, at least you can walk away with some knowledge of Shakespeare's play. So we have Macbeth. He's a hero of the day. He's a successful soldier, and he's helping King Duncan of Scotland. And thanks to his success in battle, King Duncan wanted to reward him, so he made him the Thane of Cawdor. A Thane is kind of like a baron or an earl type thing. Comes with land and money. Well, Macbeth has hopes of being king someday, and he's basing this on some prophecies that were given to him by some witches. His wife likes that idea. She's kind of a social ladder climber, so she thinks, well, that sounds good because that'll make me the queen. So she convinces him, surprisingly easily, that he should kill the king. And that will accelerate this process and put them in charge. So together, they take care of killing the king. Then they kill a couple of guards to cover that up and make it look like the guards were to blame for the king's misfortune. And then, as predicted, Macbeth became king of Scotland. He murders two more people because they have some potential claim to the throne. So he just wanted to make sure his position was very secure. So he starts to get a little bit overconfident. He goes to the witches again, gets some more prophecies, but this time they're a little bit more cryptic and he's not understanding them quite the way he should. So at this point, he's racked up quite a body count. And others start getting suspicious of Macbeth and think, you know, there's treachery going on. Not surprising. It all seems a bit convenient for Macbeth. So they form an army against him. So that's kind of the main story. That's kind of very condensed, but it's the main story about what's going on in Macbeth's life. But there's a character in the background that I want to talk about for this purpose, and that's his wife, Lady Macbeth. We kind of see her at the beginning, and she started out as a strong character. In fact, at one point, she called her husband weak because he was having a lot of trouble with all the murders that he was doing. But she told him, don't worry about it. But later on in the play, we don't see her for a little while, then later on in the play, towards the end, we see her again. And we discover that deep down, all of this treachery and murder is really not sitting right with her. She's begun sleepwalking. And they show her sleepwalking. She's wringing her hands as if she's watching them, trying to get the blood of the king off her hands. And she realizes that nothing will get rid of the smell of the blood. Not all the perfumes of Arabia, she says, will get rid of the smell of the blood. And nothing can get rid of the guilt from causing the death of these men through her and her husband's own ambition. And eventually, in the end, the guilt drives her to madness, and it's implied to suicide. She dies, but doesn't show suicide, but there's an implication. And the fate of her husband? Well, he dies. He's defeated in battle. They close out a true Shakespearean tragedy. But this is a case where guilt of what she had done ate away at her, creating more and more unrest. And this unrest came to her, especially when she was sleeping, and it was causing her to sleepwalk and act out the cleansing routine to try and rid herself of the blood, along with the memory and the guilt. So is there something bothering you today? Do you wring your hands and worry about something you did? Not the murder of a king, but something that you said or did that you feel guilty about. Is there something that doesn't sit right with you now? Bothers you into sleepless nights? Is there a rift between you and someone that you know based on something that you said or something that, or some guilt that you feel? So we get back to David, verse 5. He now begins to offer the solution to this. And this is the part where the teaching starts in the song. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. And you forgave the guilt of my sin. In his deepest despair, the feeling and weight of his guilt, he confesses, he acknowledges his sin, and he leaves nothing out. God knows what he's done. What a pointless thing it is to leave out anything in a confession to God. He repeats it, and then there's a short sentence that packs the power of this psalm. And you forgave the guilt of my sin. Not just the sin is forgiven, but the guilt, or as it says in the New King James Version, the iniquity, the guilt of the sin is also forgiven. It's gone, vanished. If you look at the size of power ratios of sentences in the Bible, this one has a pretty high score. It's a very short sentence, and it's not even a full verse, it's a third of a verse. Because here is the core of it all. It is forgiven. David goes on, therefore, let all faithful pray to you where you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. Verse 8, I, because now he's talking to the first person of God, will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I, still God, will counsel you with the loving eye on you. Do not be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one who trusts in him. Verse 5 was the turnaround, and now he gives the advice. Pray to God in your faith. The rising waters of trouble, even though the waters might seem so high that it's hopeless, they won't reach a praying man or a woman. We'll be protected in our prayers to the Lord. We must not be like a horse or a mule who has to be led by a bit or a bridle. In other words, we cannot be so stubborn that we have to be dragged to the Lord. We must first trust in the Lord and of his love and realize that it will always prevail. So now we see a pathway for the relief of guilt and a relief of the torment in our lives. David, weighed down by his guilt of the sin of an adulterous affair and his plan to dispose of the husband, seemed irretrievable. How far had he fallen? He was the anointed king of Israel, of God's people, suddenly an adulterer and a murderer. This was very real, tangible guilt to him, but he had the solution of how to overcome it. He is clear in this song that he didn't have exclusive rights to this. He says, let all the faithful pray, all of the faithful. His celebration of this fact that he'd been forgiven, many want to spread the good news, and it's available to all. You just have to have faith in God and pray. But back to the note on the car windshield. It's a simple message from someone anonymous. I know what you did. So we begin to scroll through the sins in our life and trying to pinpoint one that you may be talking about. We may need to put some of these in perspective as we do that, but we start thinking, was it the candy I stole when I was a kid from that store? Was it a paper that we copied when I was a student and passed it off as my own? Was it that extra tax credit I gave myself on my last tax return? Or was it the secret meeting with a coworker that we've been flirting with for a month and now it's turned into a full-blown affair? Or was it seemingly smaller things? A cutting word that we said to our children that we wish had never come out of our mouth? The extra donut for breakfast that we've been trying to avoid? Or was it just not holding open the door for someone who really needed it? What seems like the smallest thing to one person may be an unbearable weight to another. One of the tragic occurrences in life is that people occasionally lose limbs. But their loss can be made even severe by a phantom limb pain. Phantom limb pain occurs when a patient's brain acts like the limb is still there, and they may have a perception of an itch, or they may feel the curling toes on a limb that's not even existing anymore. Or even worse, they may feel tremendous pain in their non-existent limb. Dr. Paul Brand tells us of one of his patients, Mr. Barrick, who had a serious and painful circulation problem in his leg. The doctors recommended amputation, but Mr. Barrick refused. Finally, the pain became too intense, so he agreed to the operation. In the lead up to the operation, Mr. Barrick grew to hate the leg so much that he asked the doctor to preserve it in a pickling jar. And he planned to place it on his mantelpiece so he could sit in his armchair and taunt it, saying, ha, you can't hurt me anymore. The doctor followed Mr. Barrick's instructions, but sadly, it was the leg that got the last laugh. You see, Mr. Barrick developed a severe case of phantom limb pain. He had hated the leg with such intensity that the pain of the wound lodged itself permanently in his brain. And Dr. Brand suggests that phantom limb pain provides a wonderful insight into the phenomenon of false guilt. Christians sometimes could become obsessed with the memory of a sin committed years ago. It never leaves them. It's embedded in their brain permanently. It cripples their ministries, their devotional life, their relationship with others, because they live in fear that someday it will come out in the open and people will discover their past. They work overtime trying to prove to God that they're truly repentant. But in this process, they become as pitiful as Mr. Barrick, sitting in his armchair, shaking his fist at his leg sitting on the mantel. Sometimes our guilt is unnecessary. What we've done to one person and haunts us to this day may not have affected the other person in quite the way that we expected it. Have you ever said to someone, I'm really sorry for that thing that I did? And they look at you like, oh, that, yeah, don't worry, I've forgotten about it. It's no big deal. And you're thinking, no big deal. I just spent 3 restless nights thinking about the fact that I'd wronged you and I'd jeopardized our friendship. But apparently it was no big deal. In fact, you barely remember it. Sometimes we give the power to these things. We enlarge them in our own minds, and we create non-existent need for guilt and anxiety. We build up issues in our own mind that are non-issues, and we bring ourselves down with them, when what we really need to do is release them to God. So we look at the key to David's teaching, the process that he instructs us to follow. We acknowledge our sin, and we all sin. We are, by very nature, sinful. But it's how we handle our sin that will change the way we live. If you're holding on to some sin, no matter how deep it's pushed down, if you feel that twinge of guilt when you think about the note on the windshield saying, "I know what you did," then David is talking to you through Psalm 32. You can't expect the freedom and joy of life if you're dragging around a 300-pound rock of guilt. You may not even realize how much it's holding you back. You may not realize it until it's gone. Pastor Tim, after his surgery with his stent, said that he felt better than before. He didn't realize his body wasn't acting as efficiently as it should. Sometimes you don't realize that you're being held back. We may not even know that we have something holding us back or stopping us fulfilling our full potential in life. So push this investigation deep. See if you find something unresolved in your life and bring it to the light. The first step is to acknowledge that it's there. And once you know what's binding you, make sure it's out in the light for you to see. Not others, for you to see. Don't hold anything back. As David said, "And my iniquity I did not hide." Then we confess to God what our sins are. This is the release. We put it out on the table in the light, we find it, and we show it to God. Confess outwardly to him that this is my sin. We need to own it. God knows whose sin it is, and he wants us to tell him, because by doing so we'll free ourselves. This process of giving it to God is a process of ending the guilt, and we no longer need to inwardly hold on to it so it gnaws at us. Why do we need to do that? Well, here it is again, the core of this psalm. Because God will forgive the guilt of our sin. God will accept the sin we've owned and confessed, and he will give it to us. He will forgive it and free us from the burden of the 300-pound rock that he'll cut the chain to. He wants us to leave it behind so that we are free to move on with our lives and fulfill his role for us unrestrained. But wait, this is Old Testament. That sounds like New Testament stuff. But God has always forgiven sins. He's always loved us and offered grace to us despite what we do against him. Jesus died for us so that he can be a permanent sacrifice for our sins. We can confess and he will forgive us. The Bible is littered with quotes on this, both in the Old and the New Testament. Daniel 9:9 says, "God is merciful and forgiving, even though we have rebelled against him." Isaiah 1:18, "Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they will be like wool." 1 John 1:9, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness." So we have to ask ourselves this question. Why do we have fear about our confession to God? What do we fear about bringing our deepest, darkest, guilty sin to God? It's a matter of trust. It's trusting God to take the sin that we confess and transform it into the joy that comes from living in a forgiving love of God. In the words of Queen Elsa, you know, from the Disney movie Frozen, "Let it go." We have to open up our hand and release the sin. Along with it should go the guilt, because we know that we're no longer hostage to that sin. God has freed us from that. So let's summarize this in 4 steps. Number 1, understand the source of your guilt. Without understanding what it is you feel guilty about, you have no hope of ever finding peace from it. This is where we listen to the first thing that comes to our mind when you read the note, "I know what you did." It's instinct. It comes right to your brain. Because God does know. He knows what we did. He knows more about you than you do. But more important, he loves you, even though he knows more about you than you do. Number 2 is you've got to own it. Put Blame squarely where it belongs. It's easy to say something is someone else's fault. The Twinkies did it. I ate too many Twinkies. That was actually a defense in a courtroom once. It's refreshing to realize that we're responsible for our own actions, and in turn, we're responsible for our own sin. Once we can lay it out there in the light for God to see what we're offering for Him, offering Him for forgiveness, it leaves nothing behind in us to fester. And number three, choose God. There's a variety of places we can go to make ourselves feel better and eliminate the guilt in our lives. There's places we can go that rest the storms that keep us awake at night. One is a psychiatrist. There's the professional approach. The expensive. There's drugs involved. Drugs that will numb you from the pain and numb you from the guilt. They also numb you from your spirituality often. Another can be a bar. Booze can help us forget. We have something on our mind, we have a few drinks, we don't remember it anymore. Drugs do the same thing, at least for a little while anyway. Or maybe a bunch of new friends will help. They don't feel like what I've done is bad, so because they do it too. So I'm just going to hang out with them until I forget what I did was wrong. Or we can choose God. We can pick up the Word of God, and we can use it as a tool to understand how we can move on and get past our blocked emotions, and we can start with Psalm 32. Number four is keep the faith. We need to trust that God will do what He says He will, that He'll take our confession, remove our sin, remove our guilt, and leave us with a fresh start, unencumbered and free, and then we need to maintain our relationship with God, because we all know we sin, and we all sin, and God knows it, and that's why He sent Jesus to die for us. So we need to keep our faith, and we need to keep communication with God wide open so He can know what we're asking for Him to forgive. And then we can let go of our sins and move on. But if we keep, as we keep our faith in Him, we change. We find ourselves making slightly different choices than we did before. We still sin, but we might look closer at our decisions so that what we do is a little bit different than what we would have done before. And the choices that we make become better. So let's look at the last verse, verse 11. Rejoice in the Lord and be glad, you righteous. Sing, all you who are upright in heart. This is a celebration, the final celebration by David. He's excited that he's been forgiven. He is rejoicing in the Lord and he is glad. He's telling us, be the same way. Rejoice in the Lord. Be glad in this. Celebrate the fact that God will forgive. So I want to do something a little bit different today. You should have a piece of paper. I should have a piece of paper. I had one. Anyway, so what I want to do, that's all right. On the piece of paper, write down one of the things that comes to mind when we're talking about guilt, talking about sin. If you don't want to do it here, I understand you've got neighbors. You might not want them to read what you're going to write, but at some point, think about doing that. Write it out on a piece of paper. It makes a huge difference. Then take that piece of paper and drop it in water. The paper will dissolve. It'll dissolve because this is what God does for our sins and our guilt. So put it out there, outside of your mind, and God will dissolve that sin and wash it away and leave nothing behind. But when we do this, we must pray. We must pray for forgiveness. We must ask God to accept our sin, forgive, and dissolve our guilt. So I'd encourage you to do that. There's water outside on a table outside. Well, there's rain as well, but there's water on a table outside or this bowl down here. Sometimes it's exactly what needed. It's a physical exercise that represents a spiritual act. So write down your sin, your guilt. And it may be hard to do. I know some people have never done that before. People don't want to confront their own sin and guilt. So it might be a very difficult thing to do. But once you've written it, fold it up, or screw it up. It doesn't matter. Crumple it up and throw it into the water. Swallow it around and watch it vanish in front of you. Pray and give thanks to God for the fact that we can do this, and God will eliminate any size sin, any age sin. Any sin that you feel will separate you from Him will be eliminated. It will no longer be a part of your life. But here's an important point. Once you do that, ask God for forgiveness and accept that God is true to His promise, and He will forgive. Don't bring back that same sin in further prayer. It is forgiven. How many people, if you pray on a regular basis, keep bringing up the same old thing from years ago? Please forgive me of this again, every day, every week. If you need to keep doing that, then you haven't really resolved that sin with God. You haven't truly confessed and given it up to Him. You keep need to revisit it in your own mind. If you don't know how to pray, don't be embarrassed. You'll be surprised how many people don't. Ask someone for help. Ask them to pray for your forgiveness of whatever is on the paper or whatever's in your heart. Whatever it is that you need to bring to God for resolution. We have some true prayer warriors here at New Hope. So seek one out. I'm sure they'll make themselves available outside. You'll know them. They'll be the ones eagerly looking at you. So let me close with this. No one of us is perfect. David himself wasn't perfect, and he was the king anointed by God. But God knows all this. He will take your sin and dissolve it as easily as the paper that you have will dissolve in water. He'll take any sin. Nothing is unforgivable in the eyes of God, and it will set you free. This can unburden you and help you to live your life as God intended, with a passion and a fire for Him. So grab some paper, let it out, pray and watch it disappear, and feel the freedom of God's love and forgiveness. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You. We thank You because we can go through this process. We can ask for forgiveness, and You will forgive. I just pray that we come to You with a genuine heart. We put it all out there, and we don't leave anything behind. Lord, we thank You for Your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank You for that permanent sacrifice so that we can do this so easily. We thank You, Lord, for the opportunity to get rid of old cobwebs. And we pray that we do so unencumbered. We pray in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Have a great day.